Steve Roach, our special guest, and if you are looking for the most in-depth previews to all this weekend's football, just grab a copy of our main game liftouts around the country tomorrow. Here's what is making headlines in your backyard.
In the Daily Telegraph, Joey's goal, the motivation that will make Johns Rugby League's greatest point scorer.
Tomorrow, Andrew Johns gets the chance to become the competition's greatest point scorer when the Knights meet the Eels. Johns was having a few kinks stretched out of his legs, which have carried him this far. He needs only 4 points to pass the mark set by Jason Taylor, who will be watching on as Eels coach.
Yeah, it might feel a nice fuzzy feeling, but I'm sure it's there for someone to break. I think Hasm will break it in the next couple of years, but I suppose it's nice that one day you're on top there for a while.
Johns will donate his record-breaking boots to charity.
Andrew Johns, one of the greats of the game, perhaps about to become the all-time leading point scorer. Of course, he needs just 4 points to break the record held by Jason Taylor, the current Parramatta coach. And of course, the Knights tonight take on the Parramatta Eels out there at Parramatta Stadium. We'll see this one live on Fox Sports. We'll bring you the historic moment live, hopefully tonight, if they can score enough points for Andrew Johns to accrue 4 points himself. That's from 7:30 Eastern, live on Fox Sports 1. Now, taking a look at the changes in this game, no late changes at this stage for the Newcastle Knights. Tamana Tahu, though, is out of the Parramatta Eels side. No replacement has been named as yet, but it'll be great to see one of the best players of all time perhaps hold that record, maybe at full time.
Oh, look, and a great milestone for someone when he gives the game away will probably be regarded as the best player to ever to play the game. And ironically, he might do it where Jason Taylor broke the record or set the record 5 years ago up against that coach today in Jason Taylor. So fittingly, I think Andrew Johns will get it tonight.
Let's take a look at the progression of a record over the years, of course. The first man to ever score 1,000 points in first grade rugby league was Tom Kirk back in the 40s, of course, and also 50s. Now, Bernie Purcell then held it. Ron Willey, Keith Barnes, Eric Sims, Graham Eady, Mick Cronin held it for 15 years before Darryl Halligan broke his record. And then Jason Taylor, just a year later, became the current record holder with 2,107. So we'll see if Andrew Johns can tonight break that record. You would anticipate it'll be a terrific moment, of course, out there. And I'm sure plenty of Newcastle fans have made their way down the F3 this afternoon to see him in action against Parramatta tonight, of course. You'll see it at home live on Fox Sports. Now, Anthony Quinn, the left winger for the Newcastle Knights, had a sensational game last week playing against the Manly Seagulls. His work with the ball was good, but his defence was just outstanding.
Yeah, it was outstanding. You know, and Anthony Quinn has done this for the Knights for much of the season. Now, he's going to be a big loss to the Knights, of course, signing with Melbourne for 2007. And it's going to be a great battle between Anthony Quinn and Jared Hayne. But and also on the other wing, we've got Brian Kearney up against Derek Grote. But Anthony Quinn has been a real workhorse for this Knights outfit this year.
That wraps things up here at Aussie Stadium. On behalf of Greg Alexander, Laurie Daly and all the crew, thanks for joining us. I'm Warren Smith, and make sure you stay with us because on Super Saturday, we're about to see history in the making with Andrew Johns, maybe about to become the all-time leading point scorer. That's next, the Eels and the Knights.
Parramatta Stadium in Sydney. It's the Parramatta Eels and the Newcastle Knights.
We've travelled out the M4 to the western suburbs of Sydney for this round 18 clash between Parramatta and Newcastle, and how quickly the game of rugby league can change. In 2005, the Eels were minor premiers, and the Knights, they were wooden spooners. Thanks for staying with us on Super Saturday. I'm Andy Raymond, and tonight joined by Wayne Pearce and Gordon Tallis. And Gordy, on paper, it's all the Knights.
Yeah, well, it is, but both sides have played really good in the last fortnight. Parramatta with two good victories. I thought the Knights were a little bit unlucky against Cronulla, but last week, Manly at Brookvale, they had a wonderful victory.
The whole week, all the talk about this game has been about one man, Andrew Johns, who is just 4 points shy of putting his name atop the list of all-time point scorers in this great game we call rugby league. Started in 1994, the Cessnock Junior. He's done it all for one club.
Yeah, well, look, Andrew Johns, what a player. What can't he do in the game? Well, you saw him kick it there from halfway, but this is a stat that's not on there. How many points has he given his teammates? He just asked the defensive line so many questions. He's just a wonderful player, and you know, for him to go down as probably one of the greatest players ever, it's only fitting for him to have, you know, the most points. And, you know, mate, look, everybody said so many things. He can even score 4 tries in a game, so you can't say too much more about the great Andrew Johns.
He has broken all type of records, and tonight it is the big one. It's been a huge week for Andrew Johns, just 4 points shy of the record. He caught up with Wayne Pearce.
It was a pretty special night for you, eh? Poised to become the highest point scorer in 99 years of rugby league in Australia. How do you feel?
I don't know, it's been a pretty hectic week, mate, to be honest. I'm happy when it's all over. It's probably something probably cherish more when you finish. Probably 2 points are more important. The way we're going at the moment, we've got to string a few together, so 2 points is definitely more important.
It's not going to be easy against Parramatta. They're on a bit of a roll.
Yeah, mate, they played well last week. You watched the video, and you know, I think Tim Smith's come back in a bit of form, and they're always hard to beat here. It's a bit dewy and a bit slippery, so I think it's going to be a bit of a grind.
Enjoy the night.
I will, mate.
He's averaged almost 9 points a game since his debut all those years ago. 239 games, 75 tries, almost 900 career goals, 22 field goals, and he sits at 2104. Jason Taylor is the record holder at 2107. It's ironic that JT is the opposing coach tonight.
Yeah, well, they're two different styles of players. Andrew Johns, so robust, takes the line on. Jason Taylor, more of a sit-back, great passing game and a good kicking game. And a wonderful goal kicker as well. And you see Jason Taylor's support play there. So to score that many points, you've got to be a wonderful player. The bonus is Joey did it with one club and Jason Taylor with so many.
Jason Taylor breaking the record here at Parramatta Stadium. That was round 21, 2001. And the Eels on that day gave the Cowboys an absolute touch-up. It was 62 points to nil. I don't think it'll be that tonight. I'm expecting a close game.
Yeah, well, look, both sides are in form and they need to win. This is when the sides after State of Origin, they start to build, you know, I try to build a momentum, and yep. I'm sure that these two sides, Parramatta, they're playing for a spot in the top eight, and Newcastle want to stay there.
Jason Taylor not worried about the record. Why would he be? He would give it up for two competition points, and he spoke to Wayne Pearce earlier.
Well, Jason, a pretty special night for rugby league tonight, but probably for you it has mixed emotions, because it looks like your record, all-time point scoring record, might go by the wayside.
Yeah, it'll be disappointing, Junior, to see it go. It's something that I'm very proud of. But I've said all week that the big thing for me is, you know, I'm just so honoured to be on that list. And Andrew Johns to go past me, you know, there's no bigger name in the game. So, and he deserves it.
I was expecting you to say, listen, we're going to keep him trailless tonight, pointless tonight. What's your chances?
Well, look, you know, that'll be really nice. But he's then just going to get it next week, isn't he? So he's going to get it. But look, we've had a good week. We come here confident. It's going to be a tough game. He's going to be keen to play well, and he's hard to hold when he does play well, but we'll put on a good show.
You really toughed it out last week. That's what I was impressed with against Canberra. I mean, you got back to the basics. It wasn't a pretty game, but you come up with the goods.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And probably, you know, 6 or 8 weeks ago, we might not have won that game. But to tough it out like we did was real positive for us, and we're looking to build on that tonight.
Good luck tonight, Jase.
Thanks, mate.
These are the career stats of Jason Taylor, 11 years in the top grade and 2,107 points, 276 games, an Ironman he was, missed very few through injury, almost notched up the half century as far as tries go, 942 conversions and 35 field goals. His name is atop the list at the moment, and what a list it is, with names like Eric Sims, Graham Eady, Michael Cronin, more recently guys like Darrell Halligan. Cronin held it for 15 years. That was from 1985 to 2000. Let's fast forward to 2006, and Andrew Johns has just 4 points to go. And there is the Newcastle dressing room. They have won 5 from 8 away in 2006. And the number 7, a bundle of energy, perhaps a bundle of nerves. In the dressing room, big Craig Smith, the front row enforcer, calm and collected. The right of screen. This is how the Knights line up. The fullback is Nathan Hinton. The wings, Carney and Quinn. The centres, Gidley and Carmont. Jared Mullen and Andrew Johns are at 6 and 7 once again. They go into the side into the game with the side named on Tuesday. The front row, Smith, Badaris, Perry, and the back row includes Steve Simpson backing up from Origin 3, Newton and Tanner. The bench reads Woolno, Riley Brown, Todd Lowry, and Kirk Reynoldson in 18, taking the position of Luke DeVico.
Now, last night at Parramatta Stadium, Joey Johns became the all-time leading point scorer, 2,108, but it wasn't the kind of night that he really wanted. But I want to show you something here, Clinton, because take a look further down. There's only two other active players, Hazem El-Masri and one Clinton Schifofsky, who is 563 points away from matching Joey Johns. Can you get him?
No.
But you had a milestone last night, didn't you? You got your 1,000th point.
Yes.
Yep. Congratulations on that.
Yeah, so it's been good.
Joey Johns didn't turn up to the presentation after the match. Now, fair enough, he was disappointed that his side didn't have the win that he wanted, but a lot of people felt it was terrible sportsmanship. How did you feel?
I haven't heard much about it, but I think there might have been a misunderstanding as well, but he's had some fairy tales, but definitely wasn't one for him last night, Joey.
Yeah, there it is, 21-08. And, of course, Jason Taylor now coaching Parramatta at the moment. And there's a shot where he effectively walks straight past him. There's the match ball presentation that was waiting to happen.
They're calling for it.
And, I can tell you that in Joey's defence, he did say in his newspaper article this morning he feels embarrassed. He apologises to Jason Taylor, and he was just gutted about it. But you could see the passion in that bloke throughout. He was struggling last night. Yeah. He didn't like it at all. Clinton, thanks very much. Before we let you go, you're going to go to Union?
it's going to be a tough week for me, and to get something sorted out sooner rather than later.
All right, mate. Thanks very much.
Thanks for joining us, and good luck for the next couple of weeks.
G'day there. Thanks for joining us. Sunday Footy Show time, and there's 1,000 things to talk about today, talking rugby league. Plenty has happened in the last week. Of course, Queensland's great series win in Melbourne on Wednesday night. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about all the results so far this weekend. And today's show, we've got a special feature on Lance Thompson. Of course, Lance has been around quite a while. He moves from St George to Cronulla this year with outstanding results. He's playing great footy. A special feature on him later in the show. As we welcome our esteemed panel, Big Sports Breakfast 2KY's Terry Kennedy.
Thank you, Fede.
TK, how are you, champ?
Well,
and Living Legend Pete Stirling. Hi. Welcome, boys. Well, of course, the big news overnight is that Andrew Johns has broken Jason Taylor's record. He kicked the goal in the final few minutes of the game last night. He has now got 2,108 points. So well done, Andrew Johns. That's about 2,100 more than I ever got. But, a great result for probably the best player we've seen in the last 15 years.
Look, it was a bittersweet night for him, wasn't it? You know, we thought that the record would go. I thought it would go substantially, but it got home by a point over Jason Taylor's old record. And, you know, he will look back and with great pride on achieving it. He just won't look back on the night that he did so with a great deal of fondness.
No, no doubt about it. 8 tries to 2, Parramatta Eels, very, very good. Look, some will say the best sidestep of the entire night came from Joey at full time. Now, you've got to give the Parramatta Club a rap here. They organised a ceremony. They got the ball and the glass case to present to Joey Johns at the end of 80 minutes, right? Because they just predicted he would break that record. He did. He gave them the slip. He went up the tunnel. Give him some credit here. He was filthy. He felt embarrassed about accepting the award after that sort of a performance. So let's not... the hue and cry that may well break out over Joey not accepting the trophy at the end of the game, I think we should just temper things a bit.
He should have been there. I think he should have been there. He would have been there if it had been a better night for them, and if they'd have gone to that... If they've gone to that trouble, I think that Andrew Johns, despite his disappointment, I can understand his disappointment, but I think if it was on, it was on, and he should have gone out there and accepted it. And I think what it probably will feel, as he said, I think, in the paper today, I was wondering whether they scored late points, whether he would take the kick at goal. It might have been better all round if he'd have waited for next week.
Home game next week at Newcastle in front of 25,000 up there. It would have been just rewards for him.
It was history in the making at Parramatta Stadium, with Andrew Johns needing just 4 points to eclipse Jason Taylor's record and become the highest point scorer of all time. It was supposed to be Joey's night, but it was his opposing half, Tim Smith, who drew first blood, cleaning up his own kick for a try.
Tim Smith collects and scores!
Josh Perry did well to stop Fui Fui Moi Moi in his tracks.
That's a big hit centre field!
But it was Parramatta on the board again, courtesy of a trademark ball from Smith to Eric Groth Jr.
And a great try.
When the visitors finally got some good field position, Johns put Adam Woolnough over, his conversion taking him to within just 2 points of breaking the record.
The flags go up.
But Parramatta had other ideas, with the home side hitting back through some brilliant teamwork to get John Morris over the line.
He puts it infield. Here comes John Morris, who scores!
With the halftime hooter about to sound, the Eels had luck on their side when Luke O'Dwyer grounded a loose ball in goal. From right in front, Morris almost missed the conversion, Parramatta going to the break leading 20-6. The Eels returned to the field, but without their playmaker Tim Smith, who remained in the sheds with a fractured collarbone. As a result, the team looked to Morris to put up the kicks, which he did with pinpoint accuracy, Jared Hayne scoring on the wing.
Hayne, a spectacular try!
Intent on spoiling Joey's party, the Eels kept attacking the line, with superstar winger Hayne in again for the home side.
Jared Hayne collects a double.
Mark Riddell was happy with his conversion, pushing the scoreline out to 30-6.
What a kick from Mark.
And the hits just kept on coming for Newcastle, with the Eels scoring again just a few minutes later.
John Morris! John Morris will score Parramatta's seventh!
Forcing a frustrated Andrew Johns to address his teammates in back play. Unfortunately for the visitors, it didn't do much good, with Parramatta scoring off an intercept pass from Johns. Jared Hayne had bagged a hat-trick. The scoreline blew out to 42-6 as coach Jason Taylor watched on from above.
And it is Parramatta's night!
At the start of the game, everyone thought Johns was a certainty to break the point-scoring record, but with 10 minutes to go, he was still 2 points short. But the doubts didn't last long, with Riley Brown scoring for the Knights, setting up Johns for his big moment.
Here it is, the kick that will break the all-time point-scoring record in rugby league.
Andrew Johns, you are rugby league royalty.
In light of the scoreline, a somewhat dejected Johns acknowledged the crowd. But it just wasn't his night, with 18-year-old Hayne scoring try number 4 and the Eels victorious 46-12. Andrew Johns kicked his way into the history books, but the Eels played their way back into the hearts of Parramatta fans, giving them hope and confidence that they can still make the eight.
But when it came to Andrew Johns, of course, he did break the record, and we caught up with him after the match.
Yeah, to be honest, I wish I sort of didn't kick that last goal. It's, I'm happy to break the record, but when I think back, I'm just going to think of this game getting beat by 50. It's, I was looking forward to this game like you wouldn't believe, and just felt gutted, probably the way I played and the whole team performance. But it's the way the game is. Sometimes there's no fairy tales, is there?
He'll be happy to have broken the record, but I don't think there's much sweet in it at all. It's there's no fun in losing games in that fashion, and I do feel, I don't feel for him, because as Nathan Kaler said, he's the best player in the world, and he has a lot of fun in this game. But I do understand how he feels.
Yeah, well done, Andrew. Congratulations. You've got the record, and who knows where it'll stop. If he plays for another 1 or 2 or 3 years, it could end up at 3,000. You just don't know. All right, so well done. Now,
3,000.
Well, this program is the Sunday Roast. We'll be talking about Origin and some of the controversy in the next segment of the program, but it's a bit of a toast and a roast this morning for Andrew Johns. You've got to toast a bloke when it becomes the greatest scorer, point scorer in the history of the game, 2,108 points, and you can add to that probably 3,000 points he scored in the backyard at Cessnock with you, Matthew.
Not many there.
But is he going to roast at the end of the game? He walked off the field. Was he aware that there was going to be a presentation?
No, he wasn't. Look, I'm constantly surprised by Joey's competitive nature, but... as I said to him this morning, the record wasn't about last night. Mm. It was about absolute excellence over 13 years. And his competitive nature got the better of him. He walked off. And people think, oh, you know, he's very selfish. He sat in the shed. Well, actually, it would have been probably in his eyes to be selfish to walk back out there. And
did he regret it, though? Does he regret it this morning?
He does. He felt when he went into the sheds that we all lost, so I'm not going to separate myself from the team. He went in there. But, yeah, you know, he does. And he really appreciates the gesture in hindsight from Parramatta.
The crowd did acknowledge him. There was a standing ovation for him. Held up before the resumption.
I can't stick it for Joey there. Yeah. You know, it was disappointing. He should have accepted it. I mean, and a very good gesture by Parramatta from the family.
Absolutely.
I want to thank him. I mean, he knocked him out of semi-finals. He's beat him in grand finals. To do that, very good gesture.
Well, what was on the Chinese menu at Parramatta last night, the Parramatta Leagues Club, may have been this duck. It made an appearance early in the game last night and was still there when Jared Haynes scored the try. And Mark Riddell. And there it is, just a little basting right there. Animals on the field. Where'd the duck come from?
Fantastic.
Where'd the duck come
from? You know it's got a new name because it didn't leave the ground for the full 80 minutes. They call it Ronnie Palmer.
Right. Or Tubes.
Tubes.
Yeah, trainers on the field. Now we've got ducks on the field to worry about. NRL David Gallop, you've got to do something about this. You've got to do something about it.
It's outrageous.
MG, slaughter it.
Andrew Johns is now Rugby League's leading point scorer, last night surpassing Jason Taylor's record of 2,107 points. But the gloss was taken off the milestone as the Knights were hammered by Parramatta. In other games, Manly rolled the Roosters and Penrith overcame Canberra, while the Eels defeated Newcastle 46-12.
It should have been one of the great nights of John's career. Instead, it's one he'd rather forget. By the time he kicked the conversion to break Jason Taylor's record, the Knights were trailing by 30 points.
Andrew Johns, you are rugby league royalty.
To be honest, I wish I didn't kick that last goal because, you know, if I remember this, when I remember breaking it, I remember we didn't beat by 50, so...
Johns acknowledged fans at the time. After the game, though, he didn't hang around for a special presentation of the match ball.
I know the game ball was out there to be taken, but I was that devastated I just wanted to get in the sheds.
Not surprising after the Knights had conceded 9 tries, 4 of those scored by young winger Jared Haynes.
Still going, Jared Haynes!
The only bad news for the Eels, a season-ending broken collarbone to halfback Tim Smith.
Andrew Johns, talk about disappointing, became the greatest point scorer in rugby league history Saturday night, but what should have been a celebration turned decidedly sour. The Knights smashed by the Eels 46-12. Joey was clearly upset with his performance and refused to take part in a post-match presentation where previous record holder Jason Taylor was waiting to present this memento of the occasion.
Where is it? I love the footage of that bloke. I didn't watch that game, I must admit. I was in New Zealand. But the footage of that slightly portly bloke just wandering around looking for Andrew Johns to give loads of plate of fries.
Did he get announced on the PA? Did someone say he is...
Andrew Johns has won the football. Yeah. Is Andrew Johns there?
Don't know if that's the case. But Andrew Johns, I believe, knew that the presentation was on. And I just think it was impolite.
I thought it was less than that. It was very ordinary. Yeah. And he's since expressed his apologies.
But since Zinedine Zidane did not come out for the World Cup presentation of the loser's medal, he's captain of the French team. And he was either too embarrassed, too disappointed in his own actions or whatever not to do, which I thought he should have.
Well, Andrew Johns has just broken the all-time point-scoring record in rugby league.
At least it takes a big man to apologise. At least he has come out and since apologised. Good on him for doing
that. But the bloke, I don't know whether you realise the circumstances, the bloke whose record he broke was the coach of the opposition team. Did he shake his hand? I don't think so. He didn't go, you know, they didn't even see each other. He was there ready to give him that football next to that bloke.
To Jason Taylor's credit, he was there... whether his team won or lost. Even in defeat, he would have been there.
Imagine if he hadn't been there, if the Eels had got beaten, which a lot of people thought they were going to.
I know.
It's just not on.
Would Mick Cronin have done that?
Does he now get... What happens to the actual... Was it a ball?
It goes down to Melbourne for the next match.
Oh, does it?
Yeah, apparently it does. It's going to get presented at the next match that the Knights play against the Storm.
Will he be there for that one?
Well, and they're not going to present one every week when he breaks his own record.
No.
I think they're going to...
Yeah, I thought that was poor.
Plenty of back chat from viewers too. Peter and Kathy Burdell agreed it was poor. Instead of presenting a football, it should have been the biggest dummy they can find. That was one of the most unsportsmanlike attitudes we've ever seen. Like a spoiled child who didn't get his own way.
I've met Andrew Johns a couple of times. Like him as a bloke. I know you do, Marno. Really? You know the guy. I don't think it's typical of his behaviour.
Not at all.
So let's just make that clear. He put a bad one in.
Yep.
And he's apologised.
Yep.
And then you move forward.
Right, now Andrew Johns broke Jason Taylor's all-time point-scoring record in this game. It's just a shame that he didn't have the good manners to accept the congratulations of the current Parramatta coach after the game. 21,108 points, tremendous achievement.
It just seems that maybe we thought more of it than Andrew did at the time.
Oh, look, I think if he had his time over again, I'm sure he would have accepted the award, but how can you condemn someone that's done so much for the game? Yes, it doesn't look good, but I can't blame him because he was disappointed in his effort, and it's a high-pressured sport, and, you know, he just wanted to get off the park as quickly as possible because he was disappointed with his game.
Before you criticise someone, I think you should try and put yourself in the same position, and I don't know, confidently, I don't know whether I wouldn't have done the same thing, knowing what you like after a loss, and particularly a pretty bad loss like that where you don't think you've played well. Before I lay into Joey, I won't because I don't know. I might have done the same thing. I might have walked off with the...
Looking back now, with the coverage that it's received, I've got no doubt that he would stay on the field and accept the award.
Yeah, but you shouldn't do it because of the possibility of getting negative coverage. You should do it because the bloke who had the record was there on the ground. He'd made the effort to come down on the ground. He's going to present him with a ball. I mean, a bit of hoopla, and Parramatta had no right to go to the extent they did, but they'd gone to the trouble. All he had to do was walk across, say, "Jason, thanks very much for the ball," and say something to the crowd. "We would have liked an interview on our coverage." The fans, the people who had come down from Newcastle to see the moment, they were robbed of a chance there to hear what the best player in the game thought about breaking the all-time point-scoring record. But he's had disrespect for Jason Taylor, I think. And what about Darryl Halligan? Mick Cronin, Graham Eady, Eric Sims, the greats of the game who've held this title over past eras, and he's basically snubbed all of them in the one breath by saying, "This isn't worthy of me taking 5 seconds to accept the ball."
Yeah, but mate, I think you've got to put yourself in a situation where you haven't played great, your team's been smashed, and yes, you can say all those things, and looking back now, I'm sure he probably regrets the actions that he did do. But high-pressured sport, you walk off the field as quickly as possible, especially after you've been hammered. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know what I was like when I played. Mm. If I was on the end of one of those performances, I couldn't wait to get in the dressing chair.
He should have done that. He should have accepted the ball. Yeah, Damien Kelly, the media man, was walking around looking at giving anyone the ball after a while. He was standing. But you're right, Loz. And I'm not going to say, look, criticise him that heavily, because I might have done it too.
Mm. I can't be swayed. The pumpkin for round 18 is Andrew Johns, which makes him a two-time winner. He's now in an elite class with the likes of Clinton Torpy. That's a famous group that Andrew suddenly put himself in.
He's not in Torpy class.
No, that's very true. He is the king of the pumpkin.
He's
now
perennial.
Big League Magazine is the complete guide to the game you love. It's got the best stories, the best photos, and hard-hitting columnists who tell it like it is. Plus, your game day lift-out gives you lineups and stats for every major competition. And for the kids, there's Little League, a great little magazine bursting with puzzles, fun and excitement. Whether at the game or watching it on the box, don't forget your Big League.
Rugby League's biggest star, Andrew Johns, has been under fire this week after spitting the dummy in spectacular fashion. Johns broke the NRL's all-time point-scoring record last Saturday night, but in the process, the Knights were thrashed by the Parramatta Eels. Johns refused to take part in the post-match presentation in his honour and has been copping flak ever since. Does he deserve the fallout? Head-to-head, we have Dean Ritchie and James Hooper.
Well, of course he does. Look, let's start by saying Joey Johns is a genius. This is nothing against him on the football field. He walked past the people last weekend. They'd taken the time, Parramatta, to mount the ball and get Jason Taylor onto the sidelines. It would have only taken 1 minute for Joey to collect it, shake their hands and wave to the crowd.
Look, Dean, here loud and clear, I'm prepared to forgive Joey for one poor judgment in a moment of madness. Look, he's been a wonderful ambassador for New South Wales, Australia and Newcastle over a decade-long career. If he had his time again, I think he probably would go the other way and fulfil his obligations. However, in the heat of the moment, he was very disappointed. Don't forget, the Knights had really been towed up by Parramatta, a team they were expected to beat, so he made a poor decision.
It wasn't a grand final, mate.
He went to spend time with his teammates and be solid to them rather than fulfilling his
post-match
obligations.
That's all it would have taken. 1 minute. I'm like you, I can forgive him, but 1 minute, that's not too much to ask. Look, Joey over the years has copped a million raps from rugby league and everyone's been deserved, but this time he did the wrong thing.
Look, Joey loves a big stage. He'll be desperate to set this point scoring record straight. Awesome performance from him and the Knights will get home comfortably.
Joey Johns also refusing to follow your script, James Hooper. The Knights are the highest scoring team in the competition and the Melbourne Storm the best defensive outfit, which augurs well for an entertaining clash on Sunday, James Hooper.
Certainly does, Case, and I'm going to go out on a limb here and give Joey, the great man, one more chance. Look, I think he'll be really looking to hit back after the Knights' disappointment of last week. Melbourne playing sensationally, but I think they are due for a loss and it may well happen this weekend.
Your brother Luke's off to the Dragons next year, so you've only got a few more weeks to play with him. What are your plans for next year?
Well, at the moment, I'm speaking to Melbourne and Newcastle, and there's another team apparently that have come in at the last minute, but... You know, they're two teams which would be a great honour to play with. Obviously, Craig Bellamy is a great attraction at Melbourne, and obviously, to go back to Newcastle, where I won two grand finals, and to play with some of my best friends and players like Andrew Johns and Denny Badiris would be a fantastic way to finish my career. And, you know, I feel like I've got a lot to offer still. I've helped a lot of the young kids at South Sydney, like Dave Falago and Luke, and I'm not stupid. That's probably one of the best things I can bring to a club is the ability to help young players. But I also know that I'm a big game player, and I'm just waiting for that opportunity once again to play in the big games.
Came out of representative retirement this year to play for Country Origin. Are you back in retirement now, or are you still out of retirement?
I come out of it to play with Craig Bellamy. My brother Ben played with him at Melbourne and had a big rap on him as a coach. And, you know, I wanted to play with the players I haven't played with for a while. And, you know, it's hard when, you know, you don't get the opportunity to play with, you know, the top class players week in and week out, which, you know, at South, in all fairness, we haven't probably got as much talent as some of the other sides. And, you know, Craig Bellamy's a great coach, so I just wanted that opportunity to play Friday night football again as well. Haven't played Friday night football for a long time and to play on that big stage. So hopefully next year I'll get that opportunity, and I really enjoyed it.
Hey, Mad Dog, for years Joey Johns has spread the rumour. Tell us the truth right now. Do you speak to your thighs before a big game?
No, I don't. But
why does he keep saying this?
Well, you know, at the end of the day, it's you know, Joey. I went fishing with him one day, and we caught a fish about that big. And I hear him now, and the fish is this big. So, but you know, it's always good to be able to laugh at yourself, and you know, build the rumours and the myths up a little bit. And at the end of the day, if you can't laugh at yourself, who can you laugh? You can't laugh at anyone. So,
and taking Joey Johns out of the equation, who's the best player you've played with in your career?
Best player I've played with, well, that's a pretty tough question, isn't it? So, hands down, Andrew Johns. I'd say that his brother Matthew was probably the player I enjoyed playing with the most. You know, whether or not he was the best player or not, but he was probably by far the most enjoyable player I played with. He just played so much for everyone else around him and made everyone else around him a better player. So, he's probably the best player I've played with.
Adam, we'll have to leave it there, but thanks for your time and wish you all the best against Manly on Saturday night.
Oh, thanks. If all the punters out there, if you've got a couple of dollars, I'm sure we're a good thing this week.
When the game was making legends, you were there. Dreaming, hoping, screaming, you were there. It's been nearly 100 years of grunts, sweat and tears. But when next week comes around, you'll still be there.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Here's the star of the show. It's the Batman, Paul Fortin.
Thank you for joining us tonight. Great footy show playing for you tonight. Of course, we're up to round 19 in the NRL. The State of Origin, long time finished. And it's back into the grunt of week in, week out rugby league. And we've got a big show planned for you tonight. We've got so much happening on the show. We've got the sexiest man in league is coming on again tonight. No Talent Time. Can you believe it's back tonight? No Talent Time. Whoopee. I can't wait for that one. Reg Reagan's back. Reg is turning up at the Knights' big barbecue. We've got ice dancing cricket star Michael Slater's coming on the show as well. One of the best comedians you'll ever see in Tahir is coming on to do some funny stuff for us as well. Great band Sunday for Cake do one of their great hits. And we have living legend, the most point scoring person to ever play rugby league is coming on, Andrew Johns, very, very soon. Yeah.
And now the stars of the show, Peter Sterling, Paul Harrigan, Matthew Johns. How is everyone? Good? Yeah! Of course, so we're getting into the heavy stuff now, boys. The race for the top eight. The minor premierships, I reckon, almost just about done.
It's Melbourne a bit like that, boys. Win, now, the state of origins, they were heading towards the finals, the grand final. You got a tip from a long way out, boys? Yeah, I like Melbourne.
I still like Melbourne. I'm on them big time.
Melbourne. I think I like Melbourne, also like the Broncos. It's also a pretty hot race for the top eight, too. Of course, Newcastle sitting down there on points underneath him, three teams sitting on 18.
Gee, Newcastle's got to mention. I can't believe that.
Very good board up there, apparently.
Top board, you're working well.
Who's the chairman up there now, by the way? Who's running that chair?
Mike Tyler is the chairman at the moment. Yep.
What's your role?
Mate, I'm on the board, but I'm on the football committee. I'm right in there giving it a hand.
Don't you worry about that. Don't worry about that. I'm looking, I know we'll talk about it a little bit more later, but I can't wait for tomorrow night. Dogs up against the Dragons. Very strong contenders this year, and I think tomorrow night might be a bit special. So
yeah, it's going to be a big one.
Okie jubilee.
Love your Friday night speed, don't you?
All right, well, of course, we all saw last Saturday night this man became, he created history, became the top point scoring player to ever play rugby league. And please, a big footy show welcome once again to Andrew Johns. Welcome, Joey.
Did you draw that?
Well, you broke the record. Congratulations on the record.
Thanks, mate.
But it didn't happen without controversy because, unfortunately, you failed to turn up at the shindig after it. What happened there? Tell us the story. I mean, they've all been talking about it on radio and whatever.
Pretty much I just spat the dummy and walked off. But, we got flogged and, you know, took the loss pretty hard, got heckled all night, so...
I reckon it was a situation, I'll be honest with you. I reckon if you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. Because I tell you what, the people that have come in and criticised, I think a lot of people would have criticised if after a loss like that you'd have walked off, or went to the presentation, smiled and waved. People have said, how can he do such a thing? This side's been flogged. His team are traumatised in the sheds.
Let me ask you, Joey, now that you know a few days have gone, would you do anything any differently?
Look, the only thing I'm probably worried about if I offended Jason Taylor anyway, and hopefully he didn't take offence to it, and look, like you guys, he's been in that situation where he's burned on the end of a drumming. All you want to do is get in the sheds with with the other players. So I hope he didn't take any offence. It was just that, I just take after my big brother, I spit the dummy sometimes.
Yeah. Like, doesn't he, Bob? Have you had a chance to actually enjoy it? Because obviously all he's spoken about is a controversy, but have you had that small reflection to sit down and go, that's a fair effort?
To be honest, I've deliberately not watched TV or read a paper just because I knew I would have copped it a bit. And, it's nice to break the record, but at the moment, you know, there's so much more on my mind, getting the Newcastle back on track and the big game versus Melbourne, but probably learn at this game.
What are you thinking right here, right now? You're torn between the anguish, you can tell on your face.
I don't know. I was just, I didn't really, at the time, kicking the goal, I didn't realise it was to break the record, and then when it went over, and they started cheering, I thought, geez, it wasn't that good a goal. And then it sort of hit home that I broke the record. But what disappoints me on the night, not only did I break the record, but a player like Jared Haynes scores four tries, a young player, and Brandon, what a great talent. Yeah. And he didn't even get a mention.
Guys, good job. Yeah. No,
we just tend to focus on the negatives a little bit. And I would have done things different looking back, but I don't think it was that big a deal.
Mate, any of the criticism, some of it a bit personal, I reckon, you know. Any of it really bite?
Look, it's all water off the duck's back, really, the criticism. And except today, someone's come out, Warren Smith's come out, and he's criticised my captaincy of Newcastle. And, you know, he can have a go at me about coming off the field and spit the dummy. As I said, I can take that on board, but criticising me about, you know, my captaincy at Newcastle's a bit rich coming from him. So I think you should pull his ego in check and zip it.
Well, Joey, it's been a bad, I guess, month for Newcastle, eighth position going into this weekend. Where are yous at the moment?
Yeah, a bit hot and cold. We had a good win against Manly 2 weeks ago. But, you know, all the signs were really positive going into Parramatta. But, you know, not enough's been said about their performance.
Yeah,
they played
great.
Especially in the forwards. They were really strong in the forwards and they capitalised, scored a few tries off kicks. But you can't invite teams down your own end to score off kicks. But big game this weekend for Newcastle. We get our first day game for about 2 months and I think we're a different team in the day. And
you take on the Storm up at Newcastle this week.
Yeah. It'll be tough, but
I've got to say the last 6 weeks has been a pretty tough time for the club. But yourself, you judge yourself pretty hard. It's been a bit of a dry spell for you. Now, your brother said there
on the field,
been a dry spell.
No way, it's been a dry spell off the field. That's probably spooking out of school. I did sleep on the top bunk.
But even Matty said that he probably put it down a little bit to the fact that you're not playing in the Origin Arena.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that? Is that the case?
Yeah, definitely. I think after I finished the test match, there wasn't sort of something there to strive for. Mm. I found myself struggling a bit for motivation and stuff, but feel like I've had an attitude readjustment myself and trying to be more positive with my football, and hopefully it'll show this weekend.
Joe, just back, of all the goals you've ever kicked, you know, goals, tries, is there any game or any goal or try that really sticks out and you say, hey, that was something special?
Yeah, I kicked one at Wembley in 95, which stands out. The semi-final leading up to it, I kicked about 2 from 7 and didn't have the greatest confidence going in the final, but kicked one from the sideline, so that's probably understandable.
So that's really impressive, isn't it, Fatty? Like, he scored so many points. It's easy for us to remember. I think I scored 6 tries in 15 years. I can easily remember which was the best try.
I quite often ran 80 metres to score tries. You ran 70, yeah. 60.
Yeah. What's the longest distance you've ever run to score a try? What, 95, 90 metres?
I remember one day in under 11s for Cessnock Goannas, I ran about 30 metres.
30 metres?
That's the longest, yeah. And that's as far as I run in the off-season too, during fitness.
Hey, just finally on that, do you remember your first game of first grade? Because I tell you what I do, it was against South Sydney. And how many points did you score in your first game? It was a record.
23.
Yeah. Just amazing.
Actually, I remember that for different reasons. I actually roomed with Tony Butterfield that night, the night before the game, and I didn't get much sleep. I was horrified with some of the noises coming out of the side of the room.
Well, there you go. Now, what about, mate? Now, listen, the boots you kicked the goal over with, those special red boots, what are you going to do with those?
Just have a look at these boots.
I've got them right here, ladies and gentlemen.
Let me tell you about these boots. These are the boots, right? They're obviously going to be auctioned, right? They broke the point scoring record the other night in them. He played in them in his last test against New Zealand. He played in them during the Newcastle Knights' 11-game winning streak last year, and of course during his massive two-game stint for Warrington, he also played in them over there in England as well.
He also is a patron of Ronald McDonald House in Newcastle. Yep. The money from this will go to there. If you want to get in and auction for them, it's www.lgm.com.au, and they are as rare and as good as you can get, and is going to a very good cause
and
there.
Chief, you just left off red another W again. You left off another W. Take that.
And I haven't taken the boots off either, mate. They're still a bit dirty.
Now, the last time we had something on the show to auction, you started
off
with 5,000.
I got beaten. John Fordham, the manager, I think, he started off his bid $5,000.
Crazy John Fordham, has he?
So that's $5,000.
Well done, Johnny boy. Excellent work. John
Fordham. Why don't they call him that?
I don't know. This is crazy.
Now, Reg Reagan's been out and about. The Knights, during the week, tried to break the record for the world's biggest barbecue. We know that someone else holds that. But Reg, up at Newcastle, the Knights' biggest barbie.
Well, if you're a Newcastle Knights fan out there, last Saturday night, I reckon it must have been a very dark evening on two fronts. Number one, the Newcastle Knights getting 46 points jammed in their throats by who? The Parramatta Eels. And number two, a bit of unsportsmanlike behaviour from Barjas Johns that'll make Tonya Hardy look like Sir Bob Geldof. So I've decided to turn up today here at the Hunter's Biggest Barbecue, not only to watch the Knights train, but also on behalf of Parramatta to present the game ball to Barjas Johns. Let's go. Standing here with the Lady Mayoress of Newcastle and her three beautiful children. Hey kids, how you doing?
Not all mine.
Not all yours? No. That's what I always say too. Kurt, what did you think of that disgusting foul behaviour last week, that unsportsmanlike behaviour?
I think he's copped a fair bit through the week for it, so I'm not going to comment on it.
Oh, mate, listen to you dithering and carrying on like a teenage girl in a blue light disco has had her first taste of Chardonnay. Come on, son, get a backbone. What do you think?
No comment.
Stand there with Ryan, he loves the night, so no, he's not gay. Come and get us, ladies.
Oh, baby, come on.
Maybe he is. Well, it seems everybody's had their say on Andrew Johns on last week, but now we're going to talk to the chairman of the Knights, Mr. Mike Tyler, see what the chairman thinks. G'day, Mike, how are you?
Hey!
Well, standing here with a man who could have been Mr. Universe. Actually, I caught up with Jenny the other week. Clint, sometimes we just all f*** up.
Yeah, well, mate, I've got the memories. It's more than I can say probably for you.
You'd be surprised.
Hey, what did you think about the walk-off?
What happened there, mate?
You know, with Joey walking off, not accepting a game ball.
He didn't accept it?
No, he did. Oh, well, he didn't walk straight off. He paused for the Rolex, and when he didn't see the Rolex, he just kept walking.
He took off, did he?
So I'd love to beat that bludgeon to death.
Would you?
Yeah, I would.
Mick, Haynes, what did you think about last week when Sir Gaylord over there decided to walk off there?
Oh, he was a bit tired and emotional, mate, at that stage.
Can I just give you a tip, Haynes? I'm thinking Premier League, reserve grade.
You think so?
No, I think so.
Oh, I might have a chat with him about that, actually.
See, want me to go and break it to him?
If you want.
I'll leave it to you, okay, coach.
Thanks, mate.
Mate, if you had to say anything to Andrew Johns, because I know you haven't had the chance because he doesn't talk to the team, what would you say to him?
Pull your finger out of that massive ass of yours. Get out there and accept the ball.
Thanks very much, Brian.
No problem.
Pretty good for an Irish pufter.
On our ground, too.
Well, last week, Joey, we didn't get the chance to give you the game ball for the game, so I've brought along here at training. It's, there you go. It's got the score line, right? Jared Haynes just thought he'd give it to you. And also, mate, I thought you'd present you with this, which I thought was fitting with the night. It's a dummy. Don't think it's a dummy, mate, it's actually a butt plug.
He's a workaholic, our Reds, man for the people. Knights look after their fans very, very well. The big barbecue's been going up there for quite a few years. They get a huge crowd, but there's only been one original. You made reference to it earlier, and this is going back a few years now, but I'm sure you will remember. The world's biggest ever barbecue. What about the boof on your head there? Mm-hmm. I said to
1993.
You, this is
10th
it.
10th of October.
I've done a highlight.
And you will never hear and see a drunker man.
I'd had 1,000 drinks.
Paul Vaughton about to sing Crocodile
55,000 people at Warwick Park Racecourse. Me and the meatloaf, we're like this.
Is that the highlight, Pat? That must be one of your highlights.
Oh, mate, you Steve Miller Band was on, they were great, and meeting meat was just fantastic.
I reckon there's still people lined up to get sausages.
There are. People dead out there, they died through starvation.
Was... Now, boys, I've got some interesting letters through the week, right?
Really?
Three letters through the week that are shedding some light on the Andrew Johns situation, and we'll finally put them to bed here. This is from a supporter called George Meniscus. I think it's pronounced that right, George Meniscus. I had to comment on Andrew Johns' action after his record-breaking goal last weekend. It displayed the very reason he is the best, passion. I was so pleased that he is gutted after such a long and illustrious career. Truly gutted. Contracts and dollars do not console him. Well done, Joey, from George. So nice one, George.
Yeah, Georgie boy. Are they all nice like that?
I'm in the bedroom.
But then there was this. This one's from Donna O'Brien, Donna D. I was very disappointed to hear about Joey walking off before the presentation with Jason Taylor. I know it is a horrible feeling to lose a game, but come on, Joey. It wasn't a semi-final or a grand final. The ball will be presented this week, but sadly it won't be the same, from Donna O'Brien. So thanks, Donna. And then there was this.
Now, it's like the end of 60 Minutes.
It's Peter Harvey's mailbag. It's beautiful. Well, now this one, it was from Robin Ellis of Croydon Park. This one's to me. He goes, "Dear Matty, why do you take such great delight in attacking your brother over the way he looks and acts? On last week's show, you even nominated him as one of the ugly men of rugby league. In the past, you've had a go at him for having a big backside, a sloppy stomach and off-colour teeth." I don't know if I've done that. That might have been her observation. "Although I agree with your most counts, for once I would wish you just... would act as a role model for fellow Australian men, put the macho stuff aside and just tell your brother how much you love him."
So what have... So, please, no, no, now listen. So I've decided that... So, Joey, I just want to say this. Band, if you will.
Did you ever know that you're my hero? You're everything I would like to be.
Oh, yeah.
I could fly higher than a mongoose. But you are the wind beneath my wings.
Chocolates. Here's some toothpaste. Hey, by the way, I'm going to tell you.
But you are the wind beneath my wings.
Now, so, please, we're trying to have a moment here. So, Joey, I've given you the flowers, I'll take the chocolates back. I know that backside getting any bigger. And, mate, we've got some Colgate for the off-colour teeth, mate. Mate, I love you very much. Very proud of you. Andrew Johns.
Yeah. That sounded like the phone call he's given me from the sustained hotel of Brian Carney.
Yes, there's one for Chief next week.
Let's
from the radio.
Next week. You are getting more bizarre every week. I'll
that's a moment like we've never
what's
had on the
doing
footy
there?
Show.
Yeah. A bit of man love.
Very sentimental there. I love you too, Pete. Not really. Now, look, we've got to get there's some more controversy. You're playing cricket, you idiot. The 2020 cricket. What are you doing? What are you thinking?
It's just another... I don't know. It's just they come and ask me, do I want to play? And then I decided, yeah, I'd have a game. And then sort of the realisation is that I have to face Sean Tate or Brent Tate. And
any of the Tates.
Yeah. And
Jason Gillespie.
I don't know if it's a good idea. It's Danny Medeiros' wedding on the day before, so I might have some Dutch courage going into the game. Yeah.
Well, coming up after the break, Michael Slater, who was one of your big detractors, he is coming on. There he is. He is setting up the ball machine, and we are going to take you on. He's revving it up. Make it super duper fast, Michael. And we're going to chat to Michael Slater, one of Australia's greatest ever cricketers, about you playing 2020 cricket. Show live throughout the world, and we are joined by one of the world's greatest ever cricketers. That is Australia's very own Michael Slater. Yeah, welcome, Michael.
Good to see you, Stanley.
Oh, never forget.
Joey, you're talking to me.
Well, we'll talk about his drama here. We'll sort that out in a minute.
Okay.
Now, the ice skating, you did it the other night, of course, dancing on ice, Channel 9's brand new show. How'd it go? You killed him,
I thought. Yeah, all right. I mean, I think the main thing on the first night was just to get the first one in the bag and not fall over. And I think I achieved that, although I'm not sure about the outfit I was wearing. That nice...
Come out of your wardrobe.
I've been waiting for years to wear that. Look at their moves.
Mate, Wagga boys stick together. Now, what's the most difficult thing about taking up a new sport like this?
If you just watch now, I nearly take my partner out right there. I clipped her boot and I think we got away with it, but it's this sort of spinning and going from back to front and all the rest of it. It's all been difficult, and it's
lots of hard work. You're training every day, aren't you?
At least 2 hours a day. I think a few guys like Jake and Carl, he's got a great package, Carl. You probably saw his routine the other night. It was a hell of a package.
Notice, actually, but attention to his package, to be quite honest.
Oh, I didn't mean it that way, but I wondered what the girls were looking at anyway, but... I think a few of them are sneaking to the rink a bit more than I am at the moment. Right. So we're trying to get 2 or 3 hours a day in.
Now, if you want to vote for Slats, of course, then why wouldn't you? A good-looking young man. Of course you want to vote for him. Look! Go, Michael, go. Beautiful. Excellent work. SMS or call these numbers when they come up. All right, there he is. Michael Slater, 1902 5595. 9-0, I think promo. It says. Thank I can't you. See that.
Hey, good luck. Good luck over the next couple of months with that. Yep. But let's get back to the cricket. You were vocal about this gentleman over here, the world's greatest rugby league player He's playing 2020 cricket. Too. What's your concern about it?
Well, I was just jealous that I wasn't asked, actually. Yeah. I've had the kid out there for 2 years and sitting by the phone waiting for the call, and it came to one of the best rugby league players we've ever seen. So, no, in all seriousness, I just felt that New South Wales cricket they've gone an interesting way with it. There's no doubt it's going to work. I'd come along and see Joey Johns play cricket, but it's an official competition. So I just thought it was a... Yeah, I'll pay. Don't worry, double now. But I just thought it was a funny
move. You think it's cheapened the New South Wales jumper, so to speak?
Well, yeah, in a sense, given it's an official competition. But as I say, there's nothing against this bloke here. I'm now very excited to see him play, and I'll make the trip, mate, to see how you go. But my advice to you, make sure you bat 11. Try not to bowl. Maybe get the keeping gloves. How are you behind the sticks?
Now that he is there... What is he going to be facing? We've got the bowling machine set up here. We've got a couple of wood ducks over here who are going to stare there in front of us.
Funny lines for me, please.
How's that lid going, Jeep?
That's it. Now, this bowling machine, it's going to be tossing them down. Is this the kind of speed that Joey can expect if he gets in against Gillespie or Tate?
Can you tell us about it?
All right, I've set it to 40 kilometres an hour. Now, Sean Tate bowls at about 145 kilometres an hour. So this is 100K off what we'll be seeing from Sean Tate. So, Joey, watch closely.
So it's only 40Ks.
Now... I mean, the other thing here too is this is a selection trial because we've got another couple of Novocastrians here. They should be, you might be in the side as well if you play well. Here's the first one. You ready?
Yep.
Coming. Oh.
That's so Dutchie Holland.
I'll just pitch it up a bit.
Let's get a bit of Dennis Hurley in there.
You right, Matty? Yep. Oh. All right, so that's...
Yes.
So that's only
40k. That's 40 kilometres an hour or tick over. So
we're trying to use the bat, Matt.
It feels pretty comfy.
I mean, we're a bit shorter than 22 yards, I think, but Sean Tate. Oh. Yes.
Gracefully through the covers. What about ramping it up a bit?
Mate, do you want it a bit quicker?
Okay. You are standing on square leg. Can you
here
get
we go, Matty,
the
when
stumps?
The arm comes down. Watch the ball. Nicely played.
Look at him. It is a Rodney Hogan
Cessna. So, Joey, watching this is only 40K. How are you feeling? Like, you played fifth grade for Merriweather. This should be pretty
similar,
wouldn't
it? I think he said 140K. Oh.
That's all right. See, that's too easy. We need to crank it up now.
I think it's time to crank it up. Bring the chef in. Chef's the great man.
Sacks, if you hit me, I will not vote for you, OK? I will not vote for you.
OK, when the arm comes down, the ball will come out, Chief.
He's
ready?
Open the stance up, too, he has.
Oh, first ball gone.
How fun was that?
Do that again.
So that's about 50 k's.
That's only 50
k's.
Oh,
Chief, all right, you can bowl. Here we go. Oh, God, the slips.
That's 50. Can we have one 140 kilometre bowl?
You're on a hat trick, Chief.
Not with him standing there, but we will at the end. Here we go, Chief. Ready?
Hey, Slats. Bring it on.
Okay, all right. Ready, Chief? Here we go.
You look like Phil Tuffle.
Oh.
Right through the board. Get one up around his chin.
Well left, Chief.
Oh,
pretty happy with that.
Bit short.
One more, that'll do
it's
me.
It's about 50K.
Okay, 50K. All right, Chief. Couple more.
Don't prop on that front foot, Chief.
Oh. Shit.
Thanks, guys. That'll be great.
All right, well done, Chief.
Do you want me to wind one up without someone there?
We're going to have one more at 1,000 miles an hour.
So this is about what you'd expect.
We're talking about 145 to 150 kilometres an hour. So this is Sean Tate material. Brett Lee. We ready?
Yep.
And you blokes.
Want to see it again?
You blokes.
I didn't see that one.
One more time. Chief, jump in. Just stand there though, Chief, just to get it ready.
All right, Michael Slater, come in, Chief.
Thanks, guys.
Please stay Michael Slater for us, mate. We'll see Tuesday night on Dancing on Ice on Channel 9.
And we're going to see you. But that one isn't a crossbar.
No. So there's a few examples over the last few weeks hitting the crossbar, which is one was Joey Johns. I dared him before the game. I said, mate, you won't be able to hit the crossbar. He said, well, take a look at this. He said, how good it is. Boom. How about that? And just about the black dot as well.
Where's my
there it is.
It's supposed to be two cards.
Well, I'm about to say, you're stealing the thunder, Andrew. Your carton of Jim Beam is on its way. Just don't drink it tonight.
Look at the brotherly love, eh? Just oozing out.
I've got a few later.
Speaking of gold, It was way back in 1996 we first saw the great man Andrew Johns come on to the footy show. He made his debut on the show, and we just recap and see how he went. We've got Elvis, Elvis and Elvis from Newcastle.
Hello, you Newcastle boys.
It's a wonderful morning for the show. You get ready now, go cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. Well, you can do anything but take me over my blue suede shoe. Well, you can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. You ain't gonna look about a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't another quarter rabbit and you ain't no friend of mine.
In fact, those blokes are Matthew Johns, Andrew Johns and Steve Crowe. The Newcastle boys are going out tonight with Gerhaz Rock.
Saturday night.
It was.
I bet Steve Crowe.
Oh. What do you have near the front of his pants?
Yeah, mate, I'll tell you, it was the Sydney Morning Herald.
Tonight, what was that cute little duck doing on the field at Parramatta Stadium? It watched the entire game. It saw Jared Haynes score four tries. It was there when Mark Riddell lined up a shot at goal. But I can reveal a ruthless NRL boss, David Gallop, upon seeing this said, we cannot have pitch invaders. We must send out a strong message. And here's what happened next. Ah yes, another footy show exclusive. New NRL policy, kids. Say no to ducks. I'm Andrew Voss, just having my say. Now back to the boys.
Thank you, Andrew. And well done, mate. And great job the other night on Dancing on Ice 2. His commentary was very, very good. Now, boys, it's time for Big Fat Five.
What's going on?
What is that?
Sheriff Nova.
Can the Eels make the top eight?
Plenty of support. Look, after last weekend's win against the Newcastle Knights, there's some good signs there, but I do feel that they're a little bit too far out. I think they're 4 points away. Hey, Cover
Sweet. I'd love to say yes, they could, but it's a huge task. They've said they've won four of their last seven under Jason Taylor, and if they play like they did in the first 30 minutes last weekend, they'll win any game, but it's a matter of doing it again next week.
So what's your answer, Pete?
Well, I don't think they will, but I hope that they will.
How many points are there?
They're breathing down your neck, big shot.
I think they're four out, mate.
16, I think.
Yeah, I think they will make the top eight. They'll miss Tim Smith's kicking game, but I think they'll get on a run. I think.
You're sucking up to them now. See, because after last Saturday night, you're sucking up.
I think
to
they'll win the comp.
Now, listen. Look, you know, I mean, one of the catalyst for their turnaround, I think, has been Timmy Smith. Now he's out for the rest of the season. I don't think they'll make the eight. Sorry, boys, up there. Apologise. I love yous.
Just keep giving the ball to Jared Hayne, they'll win the comp. All right? He's a superstar, Jared Hayne. All right, now, in light of the drama over there in the World Cup, the sledging on Zinedine Zidane, can the line be crossed when it comes to sledging? Can the line be crossed on the field?
I suppose it can, yeah. Yeah, the line can be crossed. I'm still not aware with 100% that those speculation of what was spoken is right or not, but if that's the case, a little headbutt's sweet.
Yep.
I think it definitely can. I think there are a couple of areas that are taboo, racial. I think family. I think that gets too close. It's an art. There are some players who are very good. The best I ever heard, Steve Walters telling Ben Elias to hurry to a scrum because Steve had a test to play that weekend and they were both hookers. That's the best ledge I've heard.
Yeah, I'm the same as Sturlo. Racial, family and the size of someone's backside should be out of the game.
Yeah, good point. Good point. Now, look, I think, boys, same as this, mate, you know, racial family, it goes without saying.
Backside.
If it's Zinedine Zidane, mate, you're a mug if you don't headbutt the bloke. Honestly, yeah. I mean, the Italians again, can you believe it? Boys, they won the anyway, I like
you need to be careful.
Well,
you're asking for trouble, Johnsy.
I've been getting bagged for 46 years about red hair. I'm telling you, it hurts, but you just got to get over it, all right?
Who was the Frenchman? What was his name?
Zinedine Zidane.
That's beautiful.
I tell you, mate, honestly, Les Murray must be absolutely crapping himself, mate.
All right, do we care if it's Howard or Costello?
Mate, little Johnny's parent, leave him there. He's going well. Pete?
Yeah, I care. Yeah, I'm John Howard. Yes, please.
I couldn't give a rat's. I don't
are they the comedians? Hey, that's Abbott and Costello.
Oh, yeah. I don't know who they are.
What did Mark Latham ever do wrong? I mean, seriously. Look, I'm a John Howard fan, you know, but Costello, he's always got that smug look on his face. I just don't like the
He's got no lips.
He hasn't got any lips. Politicians
have got to have lips.
Is that the answer you're up?
Yeah, that's the answer you're up.
I don't really.
No lips.
John Howard's a good bloke, that's all I know.
Are they the comedians?
And now, this is a big question. Who is better looking, Maddie or Joey?
I don't care. I've seen them both in the shower, and I will say that Matty's probably the fittest. But Joey's buxom. He goes all right.
Look, when it comes to looks, I don't think they've got much. I don't give them a second glance. I think they're both ugly.
Hey, we got my good side, guys. We had a camera too.
Hey, Fatty, you've asked that ridiculous question. You've got to answer it.
No, please. Mate, look at him. Heads like beaten favourites.
Mate, look, I think it's a dead heat.
It's a dead heat. Yeah. All right, that was Fat's Big Fat Five for this week.
So from one bit of trivia to another, it's time for our Jim Beam trivia competition. I'll stump you, don't you worry about that. And because we've got the Johns boys in, it is a trivia question about these two wolf heads. The Johns boys last played together in a preliminary final against the Roosters in the year 2000. Which of the following Knights players did not score a try in that game? Was it A, Darren Albert, B, Adam McDougall, C, Tamana Tahu, D, Mark Hughes? If you think you know or you want to have a go, call that number there or text that other number there, and you might win a great prize, which we'll get into in a moment, but you were there, so you should know, Joey.
Maddie? I'll go D, Mark Boozy Hughes.
Did you win the game?
No, we actually were a long way ahead and they ran us down. We really choked on that one. But yeah. I'm gonna go for
a shocker.
I thought I was really strong.
Got punted that you did.
Who threw the intercept pass to start the half time to change the course of the game? Who threw that? Can I ask you that?
The thing is, you got punted and the next year we win the comp.
So yeah, well. Mate, I tell you, I thought I was really, really strong.
Okay.
Like your BO. I'll go for B, boys.
I don't know if you want to follow their lead. They said nothing sensible all night, but they think D. If you think D, enter, and this could be coming your way.
Each week, one viewer who calls or texts with the correct answer to the Jim Beam footy trivia will be selected at random to win this great Jim Beam prize.
Welcome back. Yes, footy show time. It's no talent time. It's back. We had auditions last week. Three acts turned up and they're on tonight. How good is that? Fantastic. And of course, it's the Crazy Johns. No talent time. $1,000 courtesy of Crazy Johns. They're great sponsors. And it's 500 first prize, 300 second and 200 third. So they're all going home with something in their pockets. How good. We've got special guest judge, Andrew Johns. Joey, what are you expecting, mate?
Don't know, Fatty.
Well, take particular note of the very first act, because please make them welcome performing Hey Joey. They come from all over Tamworth, Newcastle on the Gold Coast. They're massive Knights fans. Have written a tribute to Joey. They are Knight Rider. Yeah!
You're the pride of our nation. Fisher, hero of our hearts, but not the best we've known. We've known it from the start. You fans all of their shining night, we all admire your skills. And when you wore the green and gold, the whole country just stood still.
So you're big Joey fans?
Yes, absolutely.
Excellent work. All right, come out, come out. Don't be shy. You've got to cop your punishment. Chef, you're up first, champ.
I'm up first, am I?
Yep.
Okay, I'll tell you what, there's been some good night riders through the years at Newcastle Knights. The best being Justin Ryder. Of course, he was a bit of a legend. But look, you guys obviously do a bit of professional work, so I marked you quite hard, which is fair enough. The lyrics were good and very original. I like that, with a nice country feel. Would have liked to see a bit more harmony there from the boys in the background. Just to lift it up a little bit, but I've started you with an 8. I think you won't be too unhappy with that, guys.
8's pretty good, Chip. Stella?
Look, I'll be amazed if you don't pick up an award at the Tamworth Country Music Festival next year. I'll be keeping an eye out for you. I did take a couple of points off, because when you came out, I thought you were going to a funeral. But...
good day.
Joey.
I'll give it 10.
What's that? Double
zero?
What's
that? 10.
10
plus.
All right. Matthew?
Come on, Bernie. This will be a fun. But seriously, it was, I mean, at your 13th birthday, if someone had told me they're going to write a country song about you, well, I would have laughed. And after listening to it, I'm still laughing.
That is typical. Right, it's not bad though. You're leading on 30. Thank you, Knight Rider. Yeah.
So,
you're
like a hero yourself.
No, Nicole. What a start. How good's that? You've been practicing that for a while.
Yeah.
You love it? And Hazem's your favourite player?
Yeah.
Yeah, mine too. He's cute, isn't he? All right. Chief.
Yeah, look, I was a bit dirty on Pete for blowing the horn a bit early there, but he's used to that. But look. I'll get 100 of those. But anyway, Nicole, you know what I like the most? That's a tough act. Easy to be nervous, but you were very relaxed. That's good. Your smile was nice. You held yourself.
8.5. Still.
When you were advertising, Nicole, the skipping machine, I wasn't quite sure what to expect, but we got a skipping machine. I thought you were outstanding. The fact that you didn't strangle yourself was excellent. I gave you 7.
That's enough, son.
Just said, no, that's it. Well said, Joey.
Yeah.
Well said. And Matty?
You've got a lot of talent, yellow. Great for your aerobic fitness, too. 7.
All right, well done, Nicole. Welcome back. Time to wrap it up, boys.
Absolutely. Now, the answer to the Jim Beam question, the question, first of all, was the Johns boys played together prelim final and against the Roosters in 2000, which the following didn't score a try, and the answer was B, Adam McDougall. So I think that one right.
I thought you were there.
And also, last week's winner was Lisa Swanton of Walker in the Northern Tablelands of New South Wales. Congratulations. And just quickly, too, my old club, Lakes United, having a reunion this weekend. It's Sunday at Carl Oval. If you've been involved with the club, make sure you get there and enjoy it. See Randall Smith. Thanks, boys.
Don't forget to get Rugby League Week, which is out every Wednesday. The Rugby League Lover's Bible, out since 1970. Some couple of good yarns in this week. Go and get it. I always get it every Wednesday.
Oh, yes, Joe.
Well done. Yeah, make sure you do get it. Now, this week is Think Pink Week. It's the annual fundraiser for the Wesley Hospital Kim Walters Choices Program. Lee Grace, Darren Lockyer, Wally Lewis have both designed and created their own bras, that's right, as part of Think Pink's Bras by the Stars event. Now, they're to be auctioned over eBay to raise funds for Think Pink. Actually, Darren has used the jersey that he played his 250th first grade game in to make the bra, so it'll be a fairly unusual and unique collector's item. For more information, I think you might have just seen the website, thinkpink@wesley.com.au.
All right, boys, thanks very much. Thanks for a great show, boys. Thanks for being a wonderful audience tonight. Yeah. Thank you. Before we say goodnight, we've got some music coming up for you. One of the greatest bands the world has ever seen about to finish off the show. Want to thank Andrew for coming on the show. Thank you, Andrew. Yeah. Thanks very much. All right, and the other match this afternoon coming from Newcastle is the Knights at home to the Melbourne Storm. The Knights have lost five of the last six games as well. What about this one, Denny?
Knights to bounce back. Joey, I think he'll be very disappointed with how the Knights went last week and also walking off without the game ball for getting the points scoring record. And I think he'll be very keen to make amends there. The clash of the hookers should be fantastic. Smith versus Badiris. Everyone's saying that Cameron Smith's the next great hooker. He's got a good one in front of him, Danny Badiris.
So I still like the Storm, Pete. I think the Storm are going very well. They just seem to do all the little things right. Good quick play of the balls. Defence around the ruck is solid. Good forward pack and some brilliant backs. And Billy Slater's going to be all the better for the run last week as well.
Yeah, I think the big improvement in the Melbourne side is their defence. They've been outstanding there, especially on their own line. I think it's another step this afternoon to a minor premiership, which would be a great feat for them. And you talk about some clashes, like the hooker clash is outstanding. But Milton Thaiday comes back for the Knights today as well. And his battle, Billy Slater was superb last week in his game back. So it'll be a great game up there. But whether the crowd will get the Knights home remains to be seen. Melbourne, they win tight games this year. They haven't done that the last couple of seasons.
1993, and the streets of Canberra are empty as every man, woman and child flocks to Bruce Stadium to see the clash of competition heavyweights, the Raiders and the Broncos. And it would be the home fans in the ground record crowd who go home happy as the Green Machine gobbled up the Brisbane Invaders 20-4. Prop Paul Osborne completed the 4-1 demolition. Hello, what's this at Leichhardt? Touch judges wired up to talk to the referee during matches? Leave me out of that. Memo the New South Wales Rugby League. This isn't an episode of Maxwell Smart. And what a shocker for Newcastle's Adrian Brunker. A missed kick cost his side a draw with Manly in 1993.
Welcome back to the Sunday Roast on Channel 9. We like to take you for a little walk down memory lane. And, Matty, that certainly hit the mark for you because you played in that game in 93.
Yes, Archie Brunker. And Manly were flying high, boys. And I remember, and that's always a big game, Newcastle versus Manly at Marathon. And we're lining up and he missed the kick and the crowd just went, oh. And they
What were you doing?
I was walking back and I'm thinking right, I'm going to have a shot for a field goal from halfway. Who knows? Could be. And then I hear this awful turn around. He missed it. He went to the movies the night after Adrian Brunker. Got booed when he walked into the movie theatre. Got pelted with 50-cent pieces, slunk out the middle of the movie to get away. They booed him on the way out, hopped in his car. The car wouldn't start. He went and got petrol, put in the car. Still wouldn't start. Someone cut his fuel line. They're passionate about their football.
Missing that kick.
Yeah, missing that
kick. And now
kick.
They'll probably get him again. They've watched it on tape and they'll get him again.
Yeah, they will.
Now, listen, just on that, just while we're going down Newcastle, one from the Groover, who's a regular viewer of the program, but he said to ask you, do you remember getting the veal? He used to be your delivery boy, the veal.
Pizzaola.
Yeah, that's it. From Verdi Luna and your usual passion for passion fruit gelato and used to come to the door in your undies.
Oh, that must be the odd case.
Right?
Really?
That's a terrible thing.
There you go. I used to come to the door nude sometimes. You give me 50% discount. So, g'day, mate. Good to see you again. The Verdi Luna at Newcastle. The best veal pizzaola you can get.
Oh, there you go.
I always love being in Napoli.
Yes, we are live on NRL Sunday at Energy Australia Stadium. It's the Newcastle Knights taking on the Melbourne Storm. 1-8 on the NRL ladder as we speak. And, of course, so much riding on this particular game here today. There's a cool breeze blowing from the north. We'll see how that affects the game. Of course, kicking off right here live on Fox Sports at 2:30. Thanks for joining us for our pre-game show. Warren Smith along with Laurie Daly to take you through the next half an hour before we kick off here in Newcastle against the Melbourne Storm. And so much riding on this game for both clubs. Really, of course, Laurie. Melbourne can move 6 points clear at the top of the table with a win, but Newcastle, their captain Andrew Johns has said, if they don't win today, they can't make the top four and therefore they can't win the comp.
Well, he's put it all on the line here this afternoon, Andrew Johns, and I think we're in for a very special game of football. Both these clubs would be determined to get the 2 points for differing reasons. You mentioned the fact that Melbourne, they can kick 6 points clear at the top of the competition table, and if they can do that, I believe they'll go on and win the minor premiership, whereas the Newcastle Knights, they're battling to stay in the top eight, so they're desperate for a victory this afternoon.
Yeah, the Knights coming off, of course, that 46 points to 12 thrashing at the hands of Parramatta last week. We'll see if they can bounce back from that defeat. Let's go downstairs right now, though, to the third member of our commentary team. Once again, on the sideline is Greg Alexander.
Yeah, thanks, Warren. I agree with Laurie. I think we're in for a great game of football here today. As you said, the Storm coming to this one on the back of six wins. They've got the opportunity to make it seven in a row and go 6 points clear on top of the ladder, while the Knights, I'm sure they'll be stung into action here at home after that big loss against the Eels last week. Whether it's good enough to get them over the top of the team with the best defensive record in the game, we'll find out in the upcoming 80 minutes of football. Now, there's a couple of changes to the Knights lineup. Todd Lowry and Riley Brown are both out off the interchange bench. The new players to come in are Kirk Reynoldson and Daniel Abrahams. Earlier, I caught up with the captains at the coin toss.
Your toss, your call.
Heads, mate, heads.
It's a tail. Kick off. Which way do you want to run?
Make sure you grab yourself a ticket in the
Newcastle. Okay, so you're kicking down. Good luck.
Joey, in terms of top four, pretty important one.
Yeah, well, it's like a semi-final for us this week. If we want to make top four, we've got to start winning. Last week was disgraceful, and we just got to improve on that. We'll bounce back.
Milton Thaiday back, which gives you more options with the ball, but it's defence, it's got to be better.
Yeah, our defence has been shocking, and I think everyone saw that last week. But you know, speaking of Milton, he adds a bit of punch to our back line and a bit of speed. You know, he's a genuine try scorer, and I'd like to see him pop up a few times today.
All the best, Joey.
Thanks, mate.
Andrew Johns and Matt Guy, they're the respective captains in today's game. And, of course, the kick-off here in Newcastle between the Knights and the Storm coming up live at 2:30. The all-time leading point scorer in the NRL is Andrew Johns, who is presented today by CEO of the NRL, David Gallup, with the game ball. He broke the record with at Parramatta last week, 2,108 points. Of course, the key figure for the Newcastle Knights here once again today as they get ready to take on the Melbourne Storm. Of course, Michael Hagan had plenty of thinking to do off the back of the loss last week, the heavy defeat at the hands of Parramatta, and here he is downstairs with Greg.
Michael, big one today at home against the competition leaders. How have preparations been?
No, trained well. I think it's probably doesn't come much bigger than the game today. Melbourne are the most consistent team in the competition. They're leading the comp, and deservedly so, and we need to perform a lot better this week than we did last week.
Yeah, quality teams do have a habit of bouncing back after a big loss. That would have stung your blokes last week.
Yeah, it stung everybody, I think, and we probably didn't see it coming. So, you know, no better opportunity to come home in front of your own fans and hopefully turn out a much better performance.
Important inclusion in the side today, Milton Thaiday back at fullback.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't seen Milton for about 10 weeks, so, you know, he brings something to the team. Daniel Abraham comes back onto the bench for us. Luke DeVico comes back into the team, so I think they'll add some enthusiasm, and I think, you know, our good players also need to aim up and play well.
Hags, thanks for your time. All the best.
Thanks, mate.
Michael Hagan with Greg, and of course a couple of changes as Greg told us at the top of our pre-game show for the Newcastle Knights side. They come on the bench with Kirk Reynoldson and Daniel Abraham going in, Todd Lowry and Riley Brown, the omissions there.
It's a strong Newcastle side, one of the strongest they've put on the field over the last couple of weeks. I like the fact that Thaiday is there. He will be supporting Andrew Johns, especially in the middle of the park. He's got some pace, and he also is a threat every time he's got the football, but the strength is obviously in the forward pack. They've got a strong forward interchange bench. DeVico hasn't been playing a lot of football of late. He's keyed up for a big game. Abraham's back into the squad. He'll bring enthusiasm. I think this will be a real tight game, which could come down to the wire.
All right, it is 1-8 as the ladder sits at the moment. Of course, the Melbourne Storm, 13 wins, 3 losses coming into this game. The Newcastle Knights, after a great start of the season where they were 5-1, their record now is 9 wins and 8 losses. And, of course, they have the Panthers, the Tigers, and also perhaps the Eels now breathing down their necks. And you can't discount the Canberra Raiders also.
Melbourne has stormed 6 points clear in the premiership standings following a hard-fought win over Newcastle, a lack of discipline costing the Knights at a crucial stage of the match.
With last week's thrashing from Parramatta fresh in their minds, the Knights were prepared for battle. Strong defence leading to the first try of the match.
Has Quinn with him for the corner?
But Melbourne hit back immediately with Cooper Cronk carrying 3 defenders over the line. Cameron Smith's sideline conversion handing the Storm the lead. Sideline
hooking back on the breeze puts the Melbourne Storm in front.
Billy Slater was flying high before the fullbacks flew through for the Storm's second and an 8-point advantage.
Out a lovely grabber for Billy.
But the Knights narrowed the deficit to just 2 points with a try to Brian Carney before the break. Anthony Quinn caught the touch judge's attention early in the second.
Every time he's got up, swearing, four-letter words.
The resulting penalty leading to the Storm's third.
To Jeremy Smith, he's still going, reaches out and scores for Melbourne.
And while down the other end Slater flirted with danger, Andrew Johns looked to be in it following this tackle on Dallas Johnson, but with the captain back on his feet, the Knights got back in the match.
Here's Quinn going towards Slater for the corner. He got the ball down.
But it was as close as that get as Melbourne ran away with their seventh consecutive victory.
Gives it to Hoffman and Melbourne will win.
Storm flying 24 points to 16 with Cameron Smith kicking four goals from four. A double to Newcastle's Anthony Quinn, not enough to keep him in the good books.
Sport is next, and this is a bit of a surprise team. Andrew Johns won't face action for that abuse that he gave the officials.
No, he didn't miss him either, did he? No, that's for sure. No penalty for Joey. But the refs have been told to get tough on abuse more shortly. The NRL won't be taking any action against Andrew Johns over his angry outburst at match officials, but the league has now decided to release a post-game explanation of controversial decisions, and they're backing the referees to take tough action against any abusive language from the players.
It was a prize spray from the game's prized player. Andrew Johns responding to a touch judge's report against winger Anthony Quinn.
Every time he's got up, swearing, four-letter words, that time from 40 metres away. I'm not going to cop that.
Directly at you?
OK. Penalty, yes.
OK. Take the mark. Andrew, stop.
Mate, it's a big game.
Anthony, three times, mate.
Thanks, mate.
Any more?
The Storm scoring in the next set. Johns following Simpkins before offering some more thoughts. The NRL today issuing a warning to all players.
Well, I think players always have to be very aware of the fact that they are role models and, you know, there are microphones on the field and these things can be picked up.
Clearly fed up with the constant criticism of its referees, the NRL is taking some drastic action. Refs boss Robert Finch will now brief the media each week to explain some of the weekend's more controversial decisions, hoping to take some of the heat off the whistleblowers.
It's this fresh vision of Andrew Johns' blow-up at Paul Simpkins, which shows just how frustrated the game's leading players are with the referees. Today, the NRL decided to introduce a weekly explanation of controversial decisions.
It's been put in place to increase transparency and accountability. Where we think the referee's right, then certainly the game's prepared to get behind them and back them. Where they've made an error, we'll be putting our hand up and saying that they've made a mistake.
Sport is next, and Tim, Andrew Johns revealing all about his on-field blow-ups.
Yeah, I've got some breaking news for you too, but you're right. Yeah, it's been a pretty cranky Joey, but as you'll hear shortly, he promises to be better behaved. On-field, that shortly. John says you'll see a milder-mannered Newcastle skipper from this weekend after his controversial outburst at the officials during the game against Melbourne. Joey will be watching what he says around the referees.
John's still smiling after a tough fortnight, panned for not accepting an award for becoming the game's highest point scorer, then a dressing down from the NRL for swearing. John's admitting he'll be watching his P's and Q's from now on.
The last thing in your mind is that there's microphones out in the field. I just have to be more careful, more, you know, next time, and I'll be calling the referee, sir, and saying, pardon me, can I have a few minutes?
The Knights champion upset his expletive was broadcast into thousands of lounge rooms.
If kids are watching that, you know, you feel bad for that, but to be honest, I've never really thought that the camera, the microphones are on there, so I'm sorry if anyone's offended.
Teammates on the defensive.
It was such a competitive game and a game we really needed to win against a form side. We'd been working really hard, didn't get a couple of decisions that we would have liked, so I mean, it's frustrating. I'm sure 90% of the punters would understand.
John's looking to put the controversy behind him this weekend against Souths. 32-year-old John's admitted people who think he's getting cranky in his old age are probably right.
Oh yeah, I'm cranky for sure. I am. I'm cranky most of my life, but it's just the way out in the field, you know, you get that competitive and, you know, a few things send you off.
Well, Melbourne Storm coaches, players and fans are sick and tired of hearing grapple-tackle allegations levelled at their team, but Newcastle's Anthony Quinn again raised the issue following the Knights' controversial loss last weekend. The match review committee looked at the incident from Sunday's match but deemed no further action was necessary, and these continually unfounded allegations are starting to resemble anti-Victorian paranoia, Carl De Cru, which we've just heard more of.
Absolutely, and look, it's spreading across the country. I can reveal exclusively on Main Game that actually Michael Gardner over in the West Coast was grapple tackled just before he crashed his car and ploughed into a power pole, and apparently Zinedine Zidane in that World Cup final was grapple tackled just before he launched that headbutt. So look, if there's anything you do, if you get yourself into strife, just bring out the grapple tackle, because it's your automatic get out of jail free card. Anthony Quinn, what was he thinking? He's joining the Storm next year, and he comes out and has a shot at his future teammates. Not only that, then it shows up Greg McCallum goes through that game with a fine-tooth comb and can't find any evidence of it. The only one that did a grapple tackle was Brian Carney for the Knights. So, really, guys, look, if you can't beat the Storm, at least come up with something new to bring them down.
Fair play, Carl. Well, credit where credit's due. The Storm probably are victimised in terms of the grapple tackle. However, let's not forget, they are the ones who started it. They were the first team who introduced it and were exposed. And let's not also forget, at the start of this season, every NRL coach at the coaches' conference said, let's get rid of the grapple tackle. The refs went heavy on it early in the year. All of a sudden, they've gone lax lately. I'm telling you, it's still out there. There's plenty of teams. Melbourne aren't the only ones doing it. There's a number of other teams still employing it. It's a good tactic.
It's my theory. Look, I'm sick of talking about grapple tackle in Melbourne. They're slowing down the play of the ball, but every team does it. Yeah. I mean, when's this going to end, this constant debate?
The referees
debate
at the moment are warning, and trying not to give penalties. And as you say, they're as rare as hen's teeth.
The only penalty I can remember is that game on Sunday where Carney was penalised for a grapple tackle. Otherwise, I haven't seen him recently. St George on Friday night, I guarantee if you go through that video, you'll find plenty of examples of both sides getting in around the head and slowing down the play the ball area.
It's funny, Carlo.
The thing is, guys, it's becoming old news, really. Like, and I think we're to blame almost as much the media. And like, and I was just as guilty on the weekend. Anthony Quinn uses the line grapple, so we all put it in our papers the next day. And really, it robbed what was a great game between two really strong teams fighting for positions on the ladder. And instead, the next day, all we read about is grapple tackles, which then were shown that didn't even exist.
You're not suggesting...
How much are you on down there? Seriously, how much are they slipping
plenty.
You?
OK, it's time now for our experts to lock horns with our head-to-head debate. And for the second consecutive week, league pin-up boy Andrew Johns is under fire, this time for his verbal assault on referee Paul Simpkins.
Let that decide the game.
Mate,
we worked our out both teams, and you've decided on a...
Okay, well, mate, he's abused the touchdowns three times. He abused the touchdowns three times.
Game of men.
Well, you control your player. Go back or you'll end up.
Years ago, foul language wouldn't have made it into our lounge rooms, but with referees now wearing microphones, is swearing on the field acceptable? Dean Ritchie and James Hooper, you have 60 seconds on the clock.
Well, Case, what on earth is rugby league coming to if a bloke cannot swear on the field? The game's been played for 98 years in Australia, and ever since day dot, it has been part and parcel of football. It's not only part and parcel of football, it's part and parcel of every competitive sport in the world. Dean, I'd like to see how you're going to get yourself out of this one.
Times have changed. In the 1960s and 70s, you could do it. Please. You go up to your boss and you go back to work and say those words Andrew John said, he'd kick you straight out of the building.
Are you telling me that there's not swear words in our
rugby
office?
Rugby league
please,
and television.
We work at the cutthroat industry of journalism.
Yeah, but we're
if you
not
haven't
on
heard
three...
a few profanities here and there, you're not
Hang
here.
On, let me talk. 300,000 people watched that game. A lot of kids, a lot of children.
Yep.
Television is now a $500 million industry to rugby league. We cannot afford
Mate,
to alienate people.
I don't know what
people.
The ratings are for Big Brother either, but if you any kid who watches that show any night of the week can hear any number of swear words. It's the same when they watch movies. It's the same when they play Xbox and computer games. You can see all kids these days are exposed to all sorts of stuff.
But they don't need to hear
swear
it from their heroes, mate.
Swear words, look, it's part and parcel of society and life.
Take away the cameras if you want and take away the microphones, but you just cannot swear in front of kids. Joey Johns did the wrong thing then and he knows it.
It's a sad day if you can't swear on a football field.
We've got a standout top four. They're 4 points clear. The big battle for the remaining places. Now, some incidents on the weekend, teams that are looking to finish in that top eight. And I guess the most notable one, Energy Australia Stadium, the swearing incident involving Anthony Quinn and Andrew Johns up there. It's a big call from the touch judge at this stage
of the
game.
Of the match.
A long way from where the action was actually taking place. How did you see it, fellas?
Well, it's firstly, I mean...
Oh, hang on, let's listen.
Every time he's got up, swearing, four-letter words, that time from 40 metres away. I'm not going to cop that.
Director, are you? Okay.
Penalty, yes.
Okay. Take the mark.
No way, this
cannot
happen.
Andrew, stop.
Mate, it's a big game.
Anthony, three times, mate.
Thanks, mate.
Any more, you know where you'll end up. You'll go in the bin.
Jeez, he's cranky, Joey, isn't he?
Hey?
Imagine slipping a tee
away. I can understand his frustration. I mean, are the touch judges a little bit precious? I know you can't speak to people like that, but, you know, it was from 40 metres away.
In fact, given the context of the game and what happened, it was a huge call
to come in.
But, I mean, rules are rules. On the Joey situation, a little bit like...
Well, at the moment, let's just keep going on Quinny. At the end of the day, it's a tough one, and, of course, I'm Newcastle through and through. At the end of the day, there's rules there. You can't have a go at the referee or the touch judge. Apparently, it was two or three times an occasion. But the point is, it was so crucial. It ended up deciding the game. I wouldn't like to see a grand final or even a game more important than last weekend.
You do have to
be decided by that.
People with respect.
You know what I'd have liked to see happen out of that? When he was talking to them, saying it's happened three times, I'd have liked the referee to said, if it happens again, you'll be penalised. And this will happen. Let's go back to the play the ball. Continue on. I won't cop it anymore.
Well, maybe put on report. Like,
is
there something we can do after the game to maybe just discourage that?
But Joey's copped a little bit of flack, you know, for a few four-letter words in the heat of battle. And a little, I've got to say, a little bit, it's hard to defend him. He's such a cranky little bugger like we just saw. But it's a little bit like this, boys. It's a little bit like at the moment with television and rugby league, like we're right in the heat of action. It's a bit like being a peep in Tom and looking through a couple's window and complaining because they're making love. Like we're right in the middle of it, and it's a little bit like,
you've got problems. Can you explain yourself, please?
Sounds like the voice of experience.
I don't think there's too many people being too conflicting with Joey, because I think everyone understands in the heat of it wasn't directed at anyone. It was just a swear word, albeit the kids may listen to it. Mm. It was nothing too much. I think it's been playing on with that one.
All right. I tell you what else I saw, boys. I mean, remember a while ago we had Brian Carney on the show, and there was an incident earlier in the year when they played the Dragons of Wollongong, probably about 3 months ago, and he stuffed up a little bit here. Like, he's already out. We tried to explain the rules to him that you
stay inside the
line. Pretty simple.
Yep.
But I suppose, boys, that I mean, you got to hand it to him. He is Irish. You thought he would have learned his lesson a little bit. Just take a look at what happened on the weekend. And they're going across here. Matty Gidley about to do the flick, and Brian Carney. Talking to Brian Carney, he said that he didn't know he was out, then he heard the bench from the Storm laughing, and he knew something's up.
Matty, you've done a lot of travelling overseas. Are the fields wider in Ireland or in England or somewhere?
I think they must be. They must be. It's the only excuse I can come up with. But, you know, we love you, Brian, but please, mate, change your nationality.
The beautiful beaches and the glorious views. You know, there's no other place I'd rather be. My Newcastle. If I could make it here, I'd make it anywhere. I love my Newcastle. 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 Newcastle.
That's a bit of television gold there.
You got me, mate. I know. What about my sweaty armpits?
What about the
Newcastle?
Price and Canada deodorant.
I was going to say, what about your pants in that?
Fairly high.
What type of pants?
The Harry High pants. They're under
you. 10 years ago. It was in a Newcastle 10 years ago. So did the haircut. It was all the rage.
Mate, it was never in that haircut. But Gaz made a good point. Like Hank of Me, Myself and Irene. Has anyone ever seen that? Seriously.
It's all right.
Well, that was good.
So
that was non-sexy. As we go to this break, Andrew Voss has got his weekly wrap. We'll see you in a minute on The Footy Show.
Listen, folks, welcome to Rugby League Days of Our Lives, because I'm pretty sure you'll all agree that the last week has been a bit of a soap opera, and I'm here to explain some of the central characters and see if you can follow the storyline. I've really loved the argy-bargy between coaches Craig Bellamy and Michael Hagan after the Storm Knights game last Sunday. Bellamy said he's tired of hearing teams make excuses after they've played the Storm. He openly criticised Knights winger Anthony Quinn for his lack of discipline in last Sunday's game. And what a twist to the story. Quinn has signed with Melbourne for next year. Meantime, Michael Hagan replied, Bellamy should mind his own business, and reminded the Storm of some of their players' discipline problems this year.
Boys, the Knights at home to the Rabbitohs. And, I tell you what, the Rabbitohs have been playing some good football without winning. They've scared a couple of... They played you a couple of weeks ago, gave you a bit of a run.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. They played really well. But I think the Knights, I wouldn't want to face the Knights at the moment. I just think coming off, you know, the way they've been playing, I think everyone is going to be really pumped up.
Chief, can I ask you a question, please?
Please, mate. Mate,
an old teammate of ours is going to be playing in this game, Adam McDougall, playing for South.
I think he's not going to, I think he's going to be out with the virus, but he...
Go on, sure.
Well...
Is he going to sign with the Knights next year?
Well, look, we've basically any centre up for grabs, we're talking to at the moment, and we are in negotiation with Adam well and truly. So maybe in the next week or so we'll...
That'd be fantastic getting back to the Knights, because, you know, we know him as a Newcastle man, so let's hope...
Two grand finals with Newcastle.
Yeah, exactly.
Sport is next with Tim Webster, and more big-name deals in the league.
One of them not a surprise. Yeah, we'll tell you who's going where after today's contract signings, including Brett Finch. The speculation surrounding Brett Finch is over. The unwanted Roosters halfback today signed a two-year contract with Parramatta. Meanwhile, the Knights have announced Adam McDougall will leave Souths to return to Newcastle next year.
It's not hard to tell what Adam McDougall thinks about rejoining Newcastle.
Yeah, I'm absolutely over the moon. It's one of the best days of my life, and I just can't wait to go up there and play with all my mates again and run out in Marathon Stadium. Can't wait.
The former test winger rejecting an offer from Melbourne, signing for 2 years after chatting with former teammate Andrew Johns. McDougall's sometimes controversial three-year stint at Redfern now over.
I probably should have stayed. Looking back now, it was probably the worst decision in some ways, not staying at Newcastle, but I would never got the opportunity to play with my brother Luke at South, so, you know, at the end of the day, you know, nothing can, you know, buy the experience that I've had here.
A plan for McDougall to play the rest of the season with English club Hull today falling through. Ironically, the Rabbitohs and Knights doing battle tomorrow night. Newcastle centre Matt Gidley finalising a two-year deal with St Helens.
Adam McDougall's turbulent stint at Souths is also coming to an end. He's heading back to Newcastle, but the Knights are losing Matthew Gidley, who's off to England.
One doubts whether Andrew Johns will take up the offer.
Andrew, stop.
His blow-up at a penalty for a teammate swearing at an official caused a stir. Some can't see what the stir is about.
If you put sports ears on the school's playground, there'd be a lot of parents would be a bit rattled by the comments from their children at school.
But whinging at and about refs seems a little petty, doesn't it?
What about the Knights? They were up 24-0 at half-time over the Bunnies at Energy Australia Stadium, and then they didn't score again. The Bunnies got 18 unanswered points, and to be honest, I thought we were really lucky to get away with a win.
It was interesting. I actually sat and watched this game last night. To me, they sat down and said, well, let's go out and compete and be strong in the first 10 or 15 minutes and just blow the Rabbitohs out of the game, and they did that. They really played well the first 15 minutes and then probably just took the pedal off the last bit.
Dangerous, though.
It's dangerous, but I think they went in with a game plan, they executed, got their 2 points, and that's the good thing about playing teams like the Rabbitohs is getting your 2 points and getting out of there pretty unscathed, and they did that quite well.
Joey said that they're 5% off playing from their best and playing like a premiership team. Do you think they're playing like a top eight team and, more importantly, like a can-be top four team?
That's the tough thing at this point of the year. You know, I mean, all you want to be doing now is winning your games and starting to hit a bit of form. They're probably a couple of weeks off playing their best football. I mean, Joey can really reignite, you know, their team as well. I mean, that's key players in your team can come and, you know, have a good week of training and play some good football. So they can also compete at the back end of this season, and it's up to two or three players to really get them going.
All right, now the Knights took on the Rabbitohs last night. If you gave 14 and a half start, you had a bet at half time, you would... You know, very happy. It's an ordinary second half, by the way, I'll tell you.
Just some ordinary missed tackles from the South Sydney side. John Sutton there, not committed, the Andrew Johns tackle. Some line defence. 24-0, they got away. And as we've spoken about early in the season, they can have good patches and bad patches, South Sydney, but in those bad patches, the game gets away from them. Mm. Newcastle weren't spectacular. I thought they were a little bit fortunate here. I thought Danny Badiris was actually in front of the kicker, but it was one of those benefit of the doubts that went the home way. An important win for Newcastle.
And Brian Carney will be talking about the try assist from the kick for a long time, no doubt about it. He owed Andrew Johns a couple there. The thing about South Sydney, their last three games, they've lost by 10 points, they've lost by 6 points and lost by 6 points. But in actuality, they're no nearer to a win. because if you look at those games, St George, two early tries, Manly doing it comfortably, and then Newcastle up 24-0. It's a bit of a case of the other team relaxing, starting thinking about what's going to happen next, and South being able to score a few points in that time.
So you don't think they're going any better than they were 10 weeks ago?
Marginally better,
yeah.
Marginally better. And I think there's a lot more confidence in the club itself because of what's going to happen next year. And that seems strange because there's no difference in the playing personnel, although David Peachey's come along for the last six or seven games and has been near enough to their best. This is a great bit of work from Peter Cusack. Nathan Merritt, invariably the last try scorer for South Sydney, and he does it again.
The real concern for South Sydney is what they're going to do in the halves next year. Now, it's my understanding Ben Walker's not going to be there. I'd be trying Jay Williams back there now for the remaining
couple of games.
Jay
Williams burst onto the scene a couple of years ago. He was going to be the next best thing. And
there were a couple of decisions made by, like, Ben Walker tries hard, but a couple of decisions again last night that was so bad. And, you know, they've got to be looking towards next season now. They're not going to make the playoffs this year. They're not going to have their number seven in that jersey next season. They've got to start making some plans.
They've known it for 3 weeks, and why not? You've got Joe Williams there again. Why not just give him a chance? Mm. Give him seven or eight games and see how he goes. And it might just, for his experience point of view, it's going to be a positive for him.
All right, well done to the Knights. They hung on to win 24-18. Good on you, boys. Terrific. Now, we'll take another break and come back and have a look at the Roosters taking on the Bulldogs.
The Knights, Matty Gidley and Brian Carney, both had problems with their hamstring, and Milton Thido aggravated his ankle, but they all should be okay. So that's the news out of Newcastle. That's the injuries, thanks to Elastoplast here on Around the Grounds.
Now, I've thought for a while that a lot of blokes want to look like me.
Yeah.
And I think, again, that was confirmed last night in the Newcastle side where the ex-Bush Ranger, Kirk Reynoldson, who used to look like this for the Melbourne Storm, doesn't look anything like that now, Matty.
He doesn't. Last night when I was watching the game, I thought they'd re-sign Ben Kennedy again, or thought you may have made a comeback or something like that. But there he was. And I mean, I've got to say, guys, I think it's stripped 5 or 6 years off him. In fact, I'm going so far to say he's got the look.
I'm looking in my 30s, aren't I?
I think he looks absolutely outstanding, Pete.
But he's the kind of player that is starting to come good at the right time up there. He's had an awful run with injury over the last couple of seasons since joining from the Melbourne Storm. But
geez, what a strange game last night, the Knights versus the Bunnies. The Knights at the start, I thought, at 8-0, I thought, hang on, this could end up 60 or 70. But the boys, they really hit the wall. I can't put my finger on it, boys. What do you think?
I thought it was a woeful second half performance by the Newcastle Knights. They really should have gone on to it. Well, it was 24-0 at the half time break. The speed off the line of the Rabbitohs defenders was disgraceful in that opening 40 minutes. To their credit, they did come back, but you've got to say, Newcastle in that second half performance certainly won't be a threat in the finals.
We know Craig Bellamy's got a decision to make shortly. I think that that Michael Hagan will have one as well. And look, I'm a huge fan of Kurt Gidley when he comes back, but this Jared Mullen,
goes good.
Very impressive. And the worth of his kicking game is shown by the fact that Andrew Johns allows him to kick so often. You know,
Well, that's kind of like the stamp of approval, isn't it?
Yes.
You've got your mentor outside of you, and when the mentor says, "Hey, kid, your turn to step up," and I think Jared Mullen has done that, and he's going to be anything. I think he's one of them players who, you look at him, and you think, well, he's a rugby league player, and he's going to be a very skillful one.
His first half against the Storm was brilliant. I'm with you, Pete. I think he's got to be there. I think at the moment with the Knights, some of the young back rowers are starting to hit the wall a little bit. I wouldn't be surprised if they, you know, go a little bit different and they stick him in lock, you know, with Kirk Gilley. Good runner of the football, and it wouldn't be the pressure to create with the ball so much, just a good runner, so don't know.
And another case of so close yet so far for South, trailing the Knights 24-0 at the break, they rallied to lose by just a converted try.
To the ladder, and Melbourne remains 6 points clear of the Bulldogs at the top, and they do look to have the minor premiership firmly in their grasp. The Seagulls outright fifth. The Eels, unbelievably, now just 2 points outside the top eight, level with the Panthers.
Also, not the weather for it, but the dumped league star told to work on his suntan does just that. His view shortly.
Dumped Rabbitoh Adam McDougall today, taking his club boss Shane Richardson's advice of working on his suntan and accusing club bosses Russell Crowe and Peter Holmes at court of turning against him.
Yeah, well, I suppose Russell and Peter have got a vision of where they want South to go, and I'm obviously not part of that. I can't but help feel that when myself and my brother Luke decided to go to another club, things didn't get nasty from there on Peter and Russell's behalf.
McDougall planning to hit back with the Knights next season.
next year I'd obviously like to put some egg on people's faces, but in saying that, you know, I've achieved a lot in my career, and you know, I don't have a lot to prove to anyone else except for myself.
Moving on to something else fairly topical. Adam McDougall's three-year stint at the Rabbitohs has come to a premature end after he was released by the club yesterday afternoon. He'll be now free to take up his place, of course, at the beginning of 2007 with the Newcastle Knights. He has the rest of the season off. Now, there's been plenty of opinion on both sides of the fence when it comes to this topic. But the one thing I will say, and it probably hasn't been said in as many words by the Rabbitohs administration, is that there's a feeling in the NRL that Adam McDougall is a fantastic player and a great talent at his absolute best when he's fit, but he isn't often all that fit with injuries. He can be fairly injury prone. He's only played 31 games in his three seasons with the Rabbitohs, but he's also fairly high maintenance as well. He can be an interesting character to deal with sometimes.
Well, I think you've just hit the nail on the head there. He's an interesting sort of character on and off the field. He doesn't seem to do what I've heard out there, a lot of training with the team itself. And I find that quite unusual in the professional footballing arena that you have him and maybe his brother doing their own sort of training and only come to teamwork. I just don't know how that was ever going to be a working relationship for everyone involved. But I understand is that all the senior players got together with management and they come up and made the decision together. And that shows a good solid strength of the core players that are there and that are going to be there next year, that they're looking to go forward with all these new players coming in at the end of the year.
It's a shame it's finished this way because Adam McDougall had his best. Fantastic player to watch. And he's played some great games for the Rabbitohs.
Well, he is. He's an explosive player. And if that's true in regards to what Wiz is talking about in regards to the training, he does a great job at performing week in, week out when he's not training with his supposed teammates. But we talked about earlier on when Peter Holmes-Court and Russell Crowe took over about creating an environment that players want to come to the club and turn up every day and be happy about playing in the environment they're in. It's probably a positive sign that they've taken this step about they probably don't want a player involved in the culture they're trying to achieve. So it's another good sign of moving, small steps moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I think that's the biggest issue was a few weeks ago when Adam came out and said something about their forward pack and said they didn't have a go. And I think it's all started from there because he really hasn't played a lot of football since then. He's played, I think, one, maybe two games. So I think that's probably the big start of it.
He did have a four-week suspension, of course, in there as well.
It was a unanimous decision across the players group, the coaching staff, management and owners that it was not a good fit between us and Adam McDougall. We've said that clearly and strongly and said that we won't say any more about characters or get involved in any other sort of attacks.
South Sydney's part owner and new boss, Peter Holmes-Court, handing Adam McDougall a paid holiday worth $85,000. And with me to discuss that move and the other rugby league flashpoints, we have in Brisbane the Courier Mail's Steve Ricketts, while the Daily Telegraph's Steve Mascor, James Hooper and Dean Ritchie are with me in our Sydney studio. And the sacking of Adam McDougall won't have come as any great shock to South fans. In May, the Veterans Centre was fined $10,000 by the club for criticising his teammates. And just 2 weeks ago, here on Main Game, McDougall expressed concern about the Rabbitohs' future.
Until they get some success, players aren't going to want to go there. So I think when you buy an experienced player, you know what you're getting. You're getting a player who you know can perform, and until they get some results in the short term, they're going to have to continue to pay overs, and that's going to hurt their depth, and it's going to hurt their ability to be successful in the long term.
McDougall is already contracted to the Newcastle Knights for 2007, so he won't be losing too much sleep over his sacking. But should South have let him go so soon, Dean Ritchie?
Well, I think not. I think the whole thing's very bizarre. Why they'd want to sack their star player who's a winner, but I just find the timing extremely ordinary. 5 weeks to go, why make unnecessary and negative headlines? Same with Arthur Katinas a few weeks ago. Why do it now? They could have done it in the off-season. It could have slipped under the radar. Everyone's happy. The whole thing's very strange.
Couldn't agree more. Look, I think it's pretty gutless of South's officials to come out and say, look, we had the support of the senior players. If the senior players felt that strongly about it, well, let's see them come out and let's see them say, we don't want to play with this
player. When are the lunatics running the asylum?
Yeah, but I think the timing actually supports the theory that I don't think a club would do this. So I agree with you. If it was just a club's decision, I don't think a club would do it. But if the players actually said they didn't want to play with him, the alternative was to pick him in reserve grade on Tuesday night, and he would have squealed a lot if he got picked in reserve grade.
Have the players said that they don't want to play with him?
Well, that's the thing, but who's hiding behind who? Are the players hiding behind management, or management hiding behind the players?
I think management is hiding behind the players. I think this goes back to when Adam McDougall was fined $10,000 earlier in the season for speaking his mind. The officials deemed that he had criticised his teammates. They've had it in for him ever since, and they've decided
I agree with you in this instance, that one thing they have done wrong is they should have, the players, if the captain assistant or the senior players, they should have signed the bottom of the press release so that we knew, we didn't have to take management's word for it, that it was the player's recommendation.
When are the players running a football club? It's up to the management to run the football club. Don't hide behind the players.
I mean, we're not saying management wanted Adam McDougall to stay and they defended him.
And the Daily Telegraph took $85,000 to go and sit on the beach. What kind of a message does that send to the fans? How would they feel?
Yeah, no, I agree with you. But as I said, if it is true that the players didn't want to play with him, management were placed in a... They were backed into a corner. No, what are they going to do?
They say, you know what they say, Steve?
Management didn't want him there.
They say, we take your advice on board, but we're keeping him.
They tried to get rid of him in the hole. They couldn't get him over there. And then they've come out and made this decision now.
There's no doubt that they also wanted to get rid of him. I'm not suggesting that they wanted him to stay and the players wanted to get rid of him. But the timing is so strange, you've got to think that there's a bit... Something happening behind the scenes we're not being told about.
If Adam McDougall is so bad for clubs' cultures, why did Melbourne and Newcastle want him there next season?
Good point.